Hello and welcome to the very first in the series of DVDs brought to you by DJmag TV. Please join me on what I like to refer to as a DJ discovery. Together, you and I will plunge our heads into the darkest recesses of dance music culture and hopefully return unscathed. This month's journey is an exploration of the futuristic, stimulating world of digital vinyl systems. For the uninitiated amongst us, digital vinyl systems, or DVS, are virtual turntable systems that enable DJs to play and manipulate MP3s and other digital files in the same way as, what were those plastic things called again? Oh yes, records. Just a few years ago, the idea of a digital DJ was just a technological fantasy. But key developments in the early noughties transformed the idea into a post-millennial reality. Throughout the 90s, manufacturers ummed and ahed and scratched their heads over a system that could emulate the hands-on feel of a normal deck whilst playing not vinyl, but digital files. But they consistently failed. That was until 2001, when pioneered the CDJ 1000, a CD deck whose touch-sensitive platter gave it that authentic turntable feel, and also introduced additional creative functions, such as looping, effects, and on-the-fly remixing, which turn a lot of DJs on, I'm told. Not long after came the CDJ 800, a sister model of the CDJ 1000 that was just as effective, but more affordable. Today, these two models are industry standards, and every half-decent club in the land has at least one pair of Pioneer CDJs installed, making them the natural successor to the Technics 1200 and 1210 turntables. We asked Global Communications and Jedi Knight superstar Tom Middleton to give the CDJ 800 a run-through.
I'm really excited today. I've got the brand new, Pioneer CDJ 800 Mark II to demonstrate. If you've never used a Pioneer CDJ before, it's for professional club use, playing CDs next to turntables. The 800 Mark II has had a bit of a facelift. We've got brushed aluminium buttons. We've got a brand new high resolution, bigger dot matrix display, which allows you to see the waveform of the track. And also you can access a folder of MP3s. So what I've done is I've loaded in a data disc. And normally, with an audio CD, maybe you can get about 20 tracks on at a push. I've got 40 tracks on this particular disc now, and I can access all of them. I can see the name of the tracks, go through, instant access, very easy, very clear to see. So the auto beat feature of the CDJ 800 Mark II is great fun. It allows you to do two things. One, you can go into loop mode like this. So that's now looping. And you can divide the beat into a half every time back from here. So this is the first mode, which is the full loop. Half. Half again. And then back out again. Basically, hit the four and it'll give you a perfect one bar loop. So that's now looping indefinitely, and you can bring another track in without having to worry about what happens to this track. It's your get out of jail card free. With the jog wheel that's been brought over from the 1000, let's put it in vinyl mode, and then using the top of the platter, you can actually stop the audio and restart it again, which allows you to do some quite fun effects. So if you're brave enough. Uh, and back a cup again. Back up to normal speed. So you can kind of use the platter as a means of slowing down the track. It's a kind of a hip hop effect, if you like. One of the features I absolutely love about CDJ 800 Mark IIs and 1000s is the wide tempo mode. You've basically got a tempo control here. If you put it in wide mode, you've got plus or minus 100%. So if we listen to what happens when I slow it all the way down, that's nothing. Back up again, in the opposite direction. But obviously, the problem with that is you get the pitch changing at the same time. So if you employ the master tempo button, you can speed it up, and it doesn't change the pitch. Beautiful trick. So we're now up to like 264 BPM. Slow it all the way down to zero, which is 132 BPM, 133. And my favorite trick is the Little Louis French Kiss slowdown. So just gently slow it down. And this is a good one if you want to add a bit of drama into a set. You can sort of pitch it down, loop it. And stop it. The hands go up and you've finished your set. The 800 Mark II is so user-friendly. It's really such a joy to use. Literally from loading in a CD, it takes a matter of seconds for the first track to, if you've got it in auto cue mode, you're ready to go pretty much straight away. The layout, it's very, very well ordered, very simple to understand. The platter, the positioning of the buttons, very similar to a layout of a traditional record turntable. Cue, play, pause, track search, search buttons, pitch controller. You've got a vinyl speed adjust for the tactility, the response of the jog wheel. And apart from that, it's just a very simple selection of buttons to allow you to access folders on your data disk. The beauty of all Pioneer CDJs is that they can function adequately at home or in a club. I mean, the vibration you get in a club, there's never going to ever be a problem with a track skipping. The machines themselves buffer the music, the data into its memory and stream it back out. One of the things I really love about CDJs is as an instrument now, obviously a vinyl turntable, it's something that, you know, you don't really see people, it's never really on display because it's flat. With a CDJ, you can start picking it up and doing some fun things like this. I mean, that kind of interactivity, it's a bit rock and roll, but you know what? If the crowd can actually see that you're interacting with a piece of technology, it becomes a lot more fun. The 800 Mark II has got a great sound. You've got a digital output as well as analog, and you'll be getting full CD quality, 16-bit, 44.1 kilohertz. The Pioneer CDJ range is pretty diverse. The entry-level products are great fun. I actually have one of each, a 100 and a 200. This is a step up, really, from that. I think in terms of value for money, if you want to spend a little bit extra, you're going to get a more robust machine. It's going to be able to be used in a club context if you want. Equally, you know, it's at home at a bar, in a bar or a lounge, that kind of situation. It comes just under the 1000 professional model. So I think if you want to go to the next level, you'll be spending just a little bit more to get the 1000. But I think as a machine, the 800 Mark II is incredibly good value for money.
Following the success of the CDJ 800 and 1000s, manufacturers began looking into the possibility of utilizing laptops and software within the digital DJ realm. One of the first software systems available was Final Scratch, an innovative product that enabled DJs to utilize two pieces of time-coded vinyl and play and manipulate digital files using a laptop and a dedicated audio card. But that was not the final scratch of the record, because a collaboration between Rain, purveyor of some of the finest scratch mixers available, and Serato, best known for their Pitch and Time plugin, produced Scratch Live back in 2004. We got Benny G of DMC winning Scratch Team the Mixologist and owner of Ahead of the Game Records to show us why he digs the main Scratch Live system. And we got UK DMC champion JFB and current UK beatboxing champion Beardy Man, co-runners of the seminal Brighton event Battle Jam, to show us the merits of the lauded Rain TTM 57 SL mixer.
Right, so this is the Rain mixer with Serato built in, and basically inside the mixer is a sound card where you plug your decks into the mixer and the mixer goes USB into your laptop, and basically you can control everything in the laptop for Serato using these customizable buttons here, and you can change the buttons to do anything you want that the laptop can do, and it's pretty good. In terms of features, basically it's got the record function that was around with the original Serato, but using this mixer you can customize it, so you just press a button to start recording on the actual mixer itself, and other buttons to transfer the recording to the decks, and it's got loads of effects like delay units and band frequency EQ things. I've assigned the first group button on the mixer to record any input coming in, and the next two buttons to load those recordings instantly onto the decks. And so I think we're going to demonstrate that now.
Yes. Yes, we are going to demonstrate that right now. Yes, we are. We are. Yes, we are. Yeah.
TTM 57SL has got a really good delay function, which is particularly useful if you want to do a realistic impression of Barrington Levy.
Ooh, oh, scene. Ooh, oh, ew, well.
It's really good to use. You've got these scroll buttons on the front which allow you to go through your tracks and pick anything without touching the laptop. So I could do that, and then it means I've got two records loaded on both sides already. Really easily. Yeah, the mix is really pretty well built, durable. I've used it quite a lot. It's quite tough, haven't broken it yet. It's quite durable. I haven't snapped any of the faders off yet, which is quite good for a scratch mixer. The sound quality is pretty good. It's very loud, and it's got lots of outputs. It's got XLR outs and jack outs and phono outs, and you can control the volumes for each of those. The Rain TTM 57SL mixer is quite expensive, but it's worth it for its many features, and it's pretty sick, yeah.
Serato Scratch is not just for one type of DJ, it's for mixed DJs, scratch DJs, house, drum and bass, any type of DJ you are, it covers all those bases. It's not really designed specifically for like one type of DJ. So I'm just going to go through two of my key features of Serato. First of all, being obvious that I no longer have to carry record boxes or records or any number of combinations of those on my back anymore or in my hands. I used to go around to gigs with two record crates, one on my back, mixer, everything. I used to sort of, it's obviously every DJ knows the hassles of carrying all their weight around and on planes and trains and all sorts. The other key feature for me, I guess, as a hip hop DJ as well, what some of the music that I play, I can have two copies of the same record straight away. One of the other really good features of Serato is you can store cue points on each song. So any MP3 or file on your computer, you can give it an exact cue point. And there's five of them that you're allowed here, and they're all different coloured ones. So for instance, this record here, I've put three on already. I've put the start of the cue point, which is here. And I've put a midway cue point.
Yeah.
And a later one. And what that means is it allows you to, numbers 1 to 5 are the 5 cue points on the left, numbers 6 to 9 are the ones over on the right, and then you can just use that to kind of get your doubles exactly where you want them and your cue points exactly where you want them, and skip out verses if you want to. And also, if I do my cue points on this record and give my file to someone else who uses Serato, the same cue points appear up on his Serato as well, so it's another great feature. On first sort of glance, the actual principle is quite easy for your head to get around. You know, it's just literally it's your music on your computer mapping onto two controller records. It's as simple as that. If you want to really push it really far and, you know, use every feature that's on there where there's a lot, then obviously that's when it gets a bit more complicated and you need to spend a bit of time. As a DJ that's been scratching and being a turntable for a number of years, I don't think there's any latency, zero latency on it, which is one of the good features of Serato. I guess another aspect of the build quality is the fact that it's designed to be used in a club live in a hot, loud environment with vibrations and all sorts. So the stability of the software on my particular setup is great. I've never had any problems with any. I guess in terms of sound quality, it's dependent on what kind of format you save your files in for a start, what kind of quality you keep them, if you keep them as WAVs or AIFs, or whether you have low quality MP3s. In a club, if you play bad quality saved files, it will come out as bad quality. If you save them as high quality files and the tune's mastered and mixed down very well, it's gonna sound, you know, to the general public as good as like the vinyl, really, you know what I mean? You know, there's certain frequencies that it might still miss because it's digital like a CD or anything, but that's, you know, that's the technology of today. It's like one of the things that you have to kind of compromise and maybe do a little extra yourself to master it and push the levels. It's a middle of the range price for anyone who's starting up, serious DJs, professional DJs, producers who want to use it in the studio.
A good king fight, by my command at all times. When we go down, go to a neutral corner.
One of the newer kids on the DVS block is Native Instruments Traktor Scratch. Traktor's DJ Studio software was previously used alongside Stanton's Final Scratch, and today it follows exactly the same principles. Though it's a far more recent product, it's been causing major ripples, not only through the scratch world, but also through the mainstream DJ world too. To take Traktor for a spin, we brought in breakbeat luminary and distinctive breaks legend General Midi and Scratch Don DJ Blakey, best known for his Tuesday night BBC One Extra show, The Definition.
with Track to Scratch, in the package comes two control vinyls and two control CDs. They are then translated into this sound card, which also comes with the package. Pretty high quality sound card as well, which then goes into a USB port of your laptop, and the software translates and brings out the MP3 onto the vinyl.
One of the features I particularly like about Track to Scratch is the way you can control what tracks you're selecting from the CDJ. There are three tracks on this CD, and the one I'm particularly interested in for this is the third one. This then enables me to use the jog shuttle wheel. What happens is that switches to browsing. I switch to that one like that, it'll load that one in for me. So once the track is loaded, I can then, track one will bring me to the intro. When I've reached the start, track two is what you then use to play the CD. As I now have complete control over the track as if I was using just a normal CD. Rewind of the track. We have fast forward of the track. Now pitching. And then we have touch release. Use the cue as you would do normally to cue it up. And then when I hit the play button, we're in. It is a very easy system to use. It's been designed to not be too technical, to enable you to concentrate on what you're doing, which is mixing records. Once the initial setup stages are finished, it really is a case of just drag, drop, and play. I think the functionality of this system has been designed that in the heat of the moment, you know, when it really counts, it's going to be there and you know you can trust it and you know you can rely on it.
The main reason that I like it so much is that there is 1 millisecond of latency.
You can set up hotkeys, so you can use your keyboard. You can also use a MIDI controller. You can set up cue points on different keys. You can juggle between different parts of your track. You can bring the effects in. So you can customize it to your own way of thinking and your own way of doing things.
The sound quality of Track to Scratch is obviously all down to the MP3s that you use. So I make sure that mine are imported at a decent quality.
Being from a company like Native Instruments, who've been in the software synthesizer business for a very, very long time, it's taken them a long time to getting around to releasing their own hardware. And I have to say that the audio quality is faultless. It just sounds rich and fat and full. I haven't noticed any difference between playing with this system and using CDs, which I think you probably couldn't say for some other systems that are out there. I'm very impressed, I have to say. I think for what you get in terms of the hardware, in terms of the software functionality, and also the backing of a company that have been doing this for a very long time, I think it does, the value for money is quite high. Like I say, it's not a cheap system, but then if you're relying on something like this when you're playing out in front of people, you don't want to go cheap. You know, you want to know you can trust it.
Another newcomer on the DVS market is Mix Vibes. While not quite as elaborate as Final Scratch or Scratch Live, it still boasts superlative latency, various useful features, and crucially, weighs in at far less cost than many other systems. Jim Too Tall Coles, 2003 DMC World Finalist, gives us a run through.
We'll be right back. So what you see here is a little bit more than your common mix vibes package. I've got some of my own extras. The package itself comes boxed as two time-coded vinyls, two time-coded CDs, and also the software to install on your laptop. And you can also use any sound card of your preference that has at least, say, like two vinyl inputs from the turntable. So what Mix Vibes allows you to do, alongside your regular vinyl DJ set, which you can do as normal, you can also mix MP3 files, WAV files, and also it has a few kind of extra features. So for me, the features that I like about Mix Vibes, the main one is the VST inclusion, which I believe is a unique thing for digital DJ software. For example, here I've got like a VST synth, which I'm using alongside the two turntables. So this is a really nice, unique thing. You can have up to six turntables running at the same time as well. So it's quite versatile on top of being your kind of regular, pretty solid bit of DJ software as well. So for me, the unique feature of the VSTs allows me to kind of do a little bit more than just kind of play MP3s to people. It's very, very useful. For example, people want to use a MIDI controller with a VST instrument and also play records. Perfect. You know, if you're a DJ, say you're like a house DJ playing a soulful house, you want to play some piano solos on top of it. Bam, there's a VST synth right there. If you're an electronica band, you know, you can have your drum kits loaded in here maybe, or like for me, I've got you know, I've got this kind of Moog synth I'm using. I'm also using a wah-wah pedal for my set. And yeah, it's very versatile for that kind of live environment as well. Mix Vibes is fairly easy to use out of the package. It does require a little bit of setup, like any piece of software. I would compare it to something like Cubase or Logic, where you kind of have to install drivers for your sound card and then kind of get that to link with the software. So if you know what you're doing with a PC, it's not too much hassle. And in terms of the vinyl and your kind of manual hands-on stuff, it's pretty explanatory. It does, again, need some calibration, similar to your kind of Serato and things like that. So I'd say it's fairly easy to use, you know, but it does need a little bit of sort of tweaking here and there as well. In terms of the build, it's quite solid. Again, like I said before, it does need some tweaking. And once you get it kind of stable, you can then take that out and just set it up and go. When you're scratching and things like that, the latency is dependent on your PC. You know, like if you've got like a low kind of memory PC with like an older processor, it's going to suffer, but I don't believe any more than anything else. It's kind of like it's just a purely technical thing to do with memory and to do with your sound card. The Mix Vibes sound quality, like anything, really just depends on the files that you're using. It's a digital source, so if you're going to play 128 MP3, it's not going to sound so great. It doesn't really matter what you use, but I believe Mix Vibes is just true to whatever you're playing. So if you're playing WAV files that's been nicely mastered, it's all cool. Yeah, for sure, it's solid. So the value for money is one of the main plus points. For me, as far as I can see, your kind of bedroom DJ, start out DJ, that wants to play MP3s or WAVs with digital vinyl, this is really your kind of affordable option. And they have different tiers as well. You can buy like a basic Mix Vibes or Mix Vibes Pro. Like for example, I'm using Mix Vibes Pro 6.5, which is out very soon. But again, you know, the costs are low in comparison to if you're going to spend, you know, if you're going to buy 20 records, you know, that's what, 120 quid or 200 quid odd, and it's like, you know, this, it makes sense.
we go.
Well, as groundbreaking as these developments are, research into even more creative possibilities is constantly ongoing. One of the most interesting innovations of late has been the introduction of visual mixing into these digital software systems. And one of the first to adopt an integrative audio-visual approach has been Newmark's Virtual Vinyl, which allows a DJ, or should we say VJ, to manipulate video in the same way as audio. And who better to put Newmark through its paces than audio-visual pioneers and all-round DJ innovators Cold Cut and Brighton multimedia duo JFB and Beardy Man.
Last year, I became aware of a software called Virtual DJ, made by some French guys called Atomics. And so I got onto them, and that is the software that's actually been licensed by Newmark and is badged as Virtual Vinyl. And it was the first software I'd seen which combined a lot of elements and ideas which we were looking for to enable us to do audiovisual scratching and mixing. Just been waiting for an interface like this to come out where you could really scratch audiovisual material. Musical instruments use a standard called MIDI so that they can talk to each other, and with VJAM and with other stuff, we've taken that musical standard and seen how far we can go with that with visuals as well. So this is a percussion controller that sends out MIDI when you play these pads. So we can actually use that in combination with the video clips that we're playing. And this is great because it gives us a kind of combination deck and MPC 2000.
Newmark Virtual Vinyl sound card, and basically this enables us to scratch with videos. And so even though Beardy Man is over here, he's actually in the computer right now.
I'd say the system's pretty easy to use and set up. In contrast to a lot of hardware, the box worked straight away. First time when I plugged it in, the installation instructions worked okay. Preparing video material to be in the optimum format for this can be a bit of a pain. Most things will work, but the actually clips in DVD format are the best and run the smoothest. So you have to know a little bit about video formats to perhaps get the best out of the system. Generally though, I like the software because it's easy to use straight away, but if you want to customize it and use it in a more sophisticated way, it's fairly easy to do that. They've made a really nice kind of open interface to all the functions, and it's quite easy to assign functions to anywhere you like on the keyboard and assign functions to external bits of kit like this. Has a really good interface for expanding it and customizing it, so that's a real strength. In terms of the build quality of the Cue system, it's based on this interface here, and being Newmark, this is a professional bit of kit. All the connectors are really good, and it just gives the impression of being a bit of quality that isn't going to fall to bits. So that's nice because we're using it in for big shows, and you don't want something that just falls to bits. Raj Panu, who's a Cold Cut Scratch DJ, says that he can feel some latency on it, and actually, because he's a lot more fluid and faster with his moves than my old school Scratch is, that may be a concern for him. But I saw, is it JFB, Biddy Man's DJ? Who I think may have won the championships recently, using this system, and he seemed to be getting down with it pretty well. So I reckon latency, not a major problem. I think the sound quality generally is pretty pucker. If you use MP3s, then they're not as good quality as WAVs or AIFs, but it can handle WAVs as well. So that's really down to you to make sure your material is at the best quality. If it is, I'd say it's as good quality as CD. I think as far as value for money goes, if you compare this system with the cost of getting a couple of really good CD decks or DVJs, then it does score pretty well. As far as mixing video goes, it has the great advantage you don't need a hardware video mixer because that's done inside the laptop. So that is a big saving if you're, as we are, on the video tip. There's also the consideration that, you know, much as we love vinyl, it's pretty expensive, and there's a lot of DJs like myself whose backs have been groaning under the strain of carting around massive crates of vinyl for years. So I'd say in some ways it's that's a good bit of value as well. I think it is an exciting time to be a performer now. I think it's always been an exciting time to get into DJing and making music and making visuals. In the old days, Colcut started off just with two decks and a four-track cassette, and we made Say Kids, What Time Is It on that. Nowadays, there's a lot more people out there doing stuff, and there are great tools like Ableton that can enable anyone to make tracks. Really, it comes down to having some good ideas which will make what you're doing a bit different. So that challenge is always there, really, to do something that's original and shows your character.
Well, thanks for watching the first in the series. Join us next time as DJmag seeks to illuminate you even further on the darkest recesses of dance music culture. So, until then, bye-bye.